I've been a huge fan of Eric Rutan's for several years, for many years. Back to when he used to play Morbid Angel. Back to before that, when he was in Ripping Corpse. He's a name that's always been in the back of my mind. Number one, is an excellent musician, and then when I started becoming more and more familiar with his production work, as a great producer. Our involvement with Rutan started several years ago, actually, in the mastering session for Path of Totality. We were, you know, mastering the record. I was sitting in the studio with Alan Dutchess at West Side, who's mastered every single thing I've ever played on. And he was playing some tracks that he thought sonically fit with what we were looking to achieve in our session. This was back in like 2010. So whatever Goat Whore record was out during that period of time, that was one of the tracks that he played me. I was immediately blown away by like the way it sounded. Really extreme, it was brutal. The guitar sounded great. The kick drum sounded natural yet really punchy. So that was exactly for our next album what I wanted to do. So I just filed that away. A couple of years went by. When we were getting ready to record our new record, you know, Savage Gold, the question came, well, who do you guys want to work with? So right away, Eric Rutan's name came up. He was into it, so we ended up booking the session with him. The result is Savage Gold. What's the coolest thing about Rutan is, you know, being an excellent technician, engineer, he's also a producer, so his involvement started months before the session. I sent him a bunch of demos that I'd recorded in our space, just some reference materials of bands that I thought, you know, we should have a similar sound. So we started a dialogue. You know, he'd listened to Path Totality, and what I was telling him varied a little bit differently than what he heard on Path to Totality. By describing what we wanted to sound like and playing demos for him, we arrived at this game plan. So when we got down to the studio, basically Rutan took us through his game plan for how to achieve this goal that we had. We brought all of our own equipment with us, which we normally use live. But when we got down to the studio, we ended up using mostly Rutan's gear, because, you know, he was familiar with the way it sounded. It wasn't that much different than what we were using on the road. Your basic setup of SVT cabinets, dual rectifier, Marshall 412s, JCM 800s, you know, Marshall JCM 800. Pretty standard rock sound, except that his very specific ear was able to approve the sounds coming through the microphones using his equipment. One of the things that Rutan is mostly known for is his obsession with tuning, i.e., whether or not you're in tune, which is something that I thought I was really good at. However, oftentimes we would hit a track over and over and over and over and over again because he would hear slight tuning variations. It was a challenge to get through all that stuff, but I think that his expertise and his attention to detail is what really makes him a great producer and somebody that you definitely want on your team. Because I know I would never like to sit back and I'd fool myself into thinking that I'm in tune a lot of times. I would definitely, that's something that would fall to the wayside if I was behind the controls. Gear that we recorded with versus what I use on tour, you know, varied slightly. We pretty much broke everything down into, you know, dual rectifier, 412 cabinet, with no effects going into the board. When I perform live, I use all sorts of effects. A lot of the effects were added, you know, as overdubs and sort of atmosphere, but the rhythm tracks were all recorded dry and very upfront, very in your face. The sort of atmosphere that most people might be used to hearing on our records was added in the overdub process. Live, I usually play through two amplifiers. One is the Music Man HD 130, and the other is the Mesa Boogie dual rectifier. And then I have two Vader 412 cabinets. The Vaders are sound amazing. They're sort of based on, I guess, the Mesa Boogie design. Unfortunately, the company Vader went out of business, and so I have these, you know, collector item cabinets, which are impossible to get a hold of these days. Effects-wise, a lot of my pedal board, you would see a lot of Boss products on there, which is a very meat and potatoes sort of effect. You know, I got the Boss digital delay, the RV5 reverb, you know, of course a Boss, you know, chromatic tuner. As the years went by, I sort of amassed and some more effects, which I've been using. The MXR Distortion 3 sits at the front of the chain, to add some a gain stage or a pre-gain stage before entering the Music Man HD130, which I usually run clean with very little gain, and the gain comes off of that the MXR pedal. I brighten up that sound with a Boss chorus, you know, that standard blue box which you see on everyone else's pedal boards. That was sort of inspired by the guitar player in Typo Negative, you know, that sort of chorusy, heavy like sound. I wanted to incorporate that sound into the basic Tombs guitar sound. The dual rectifier I run pretty much clean. I would say it's probably about 60% of my sound, and the Music Man covers about 30% of the sound. So the real guts low end comes from the Mesa Boogie, and the sort of more high end articulated stuff comes from the Music Man. I also run a little bit of Phaser, which is like this out of print, completely hard to find MXR phaser, and that's more of like an atmosphere, sort of between songs, sort of noisemaker. Various looper pedals, which I use, the Digitech loop pedal, the Loop Station. On the fly, live, I'll create guitar loops just as pieces that go between songs to sort of cover the spaces. Basically, that's my setup. My go-to live guitar is the Gibson Les Paul, which I've had for, I think I bought that guitar in 1995, so it's been with me for almost 20 years. In that guitar, I have a Lace drop and gain. You know, I don't know if you're familiar with Lace pickups, but they sort of stepped to the forefront a couple of years ago in the metal, the extreme music scene. They used to be more of like a Fender sort of single coil kind of clone company, but now they're making like high output pickups for more extreme music. That's what I've been using. I've been using the drop and gain in my main Les Paul, and then also the Metal Bucker in this Strat that I have, which I use mainly for recording overdubs with. You know, if you're just starting out and you're looking to buy a guitar, I recommend just playing as many different guitars as you can, because especially if you're, I'm partial to Les Pauls. If you're looking for like a sort of, you know, beefy, like low-end sort of vibe, Les Pauls are definitely where to go. Any of the Gibson guitars, actually. The Explorer, the Les Paul, they're really good for like that sort of balls-out rock guitar, like metal, Sabbath kind of vibe. They all sound different depending on the year. Gibson has the more recent versions, the more recent models, the wood is slightly different than the older models. The Les Paul that I use live, the vintage is, the early 90s. The wood's a lot heavier and it resonates differently than the more recent models. So it has a darker like sound to it, like, you know, bassier. So combining that with the Lace drop-in gain gives like a pretty brutal like low end. As far as amplifiers go, my recommendation, this is something I did, is I actually picked some of my favorite guitar players, did some research to see what they use. You know, even though I have this like rig, I'm always doing more and more research, trying to figure out ways to improve my sound. There's websites out there which break down different guitar players' gear setups and their effects chains. Finding out who your favorite guitarist, what he uses, is probably a good starting point to figuring out what you want. Oftentimes, the gear that you're hearing on a record is not necessarily something that particular musician uses on the road, because there's different protocols for performing live than recording. Some amplifiers are better in the live setting than they are recorded, so that's something to consider as well. If you're gonna buy an amp for primarily performing live or recording, you might actually wanna get two heads. Get one that you use on the road and one that you use just in the studio. You know, same thing with guitars. If you have a guitar that stays in tune, is, intonated correctly and, you know, has the right feel, you may want to leave that home and not take it out on tour, because when you're out on the road, you're sweating on it, you know, it's falling, you know, like my Les Paul, my thing that I've had for almost 20 years, I've snapped the neck on it 3 or 4 different times. I've had to have it repaired, so I would love to have left that at home and sort of saved it some of the wear and tear. Maybe that would have been a better recording guitar for me at some point, but now it's been beaten up so much that it belongs out on tour with me now, instead of safely tucked away at home. We use mostly Rutan's gear in the studio, but it was similar to what we use on the road. I mean, for example, the basic tracks were recorded with a Mesa Boogie dual rectifier, which I have one of those, and also with a Marshall JCM 800, which our other guitar player uses as part of his setup. But Rutan, because it's in this like controlled environment, and he's obsessive about keeping everything in 100% top maintenance, we ended up using his equipment just because he had brand new tubes. Everything was like, recently serviced. Sonically, I think it just had a better sound overall, even though it was the same gear. Just his maintenance on his equipment was a lot better than what we were doing. We're a bunch of savages. We just bring our stuff out, we crank it as loud as it can go, and beat it into the ground. We never think about keeping things in good working order. Things are breaking, tubes are getting blown out, everything falls into disrepair, at least with us. And Rutan, being the perfectionist, keeps everything in top working order down in his studio. So that's primarily why we used all of his gear on this record. But with that said, it shows, because I think everything sounds great, and it's not a huge departure from our sound on the basic tracks. I used to wear my guitar really low because I thought it looked cool, like Johnny Ramone and those types of dudes like wore their guitars like super low. But it was really hard to play. When you're not playing Blitzkrieg Bop and you're trying to play something that actually has like some articulation, keeping your guitar really low is creating an obstacle which you necessarily don't really need. Over the years, my guitar has gotten higher and higher and higher, and it's easier to play. My moves are pretty basic, I like to point at people, I like to stare off to the back of the room maybe. There was a period of time where I smashed people with the neck, headstock on my guitar. But that was more when we were playing basement shows, a more one-on-one experience. And that's where the damage on my guitar actually happened, when I was like swinging it and it caught someone in the face accidentally, and I broke the headstock on the guitar. I never repaired, so I stopped doing that. Nowadays, there's a little bit more distance between us and the audience, so most people are safe from being attacked from the stage. Some of the things I hate the most in guitar moves is like when they do that like LA like flip where you sort of flip it over and it makes this circumferential move around your body. Like, you can only really do that when you have a wireless setup, and I think I can't afford a wireless setup, and it makes me feel really insecure about that. And also it just smacks of weakness when you do that. I just think of like dudes with like teased hair and makeup and that kind of thing, which is, that's cool if that's your thing, but it's not really my thing.